this morning? My name is Daniel Davalos. I am the campus minister with RUF here at New Mexico State University. That means that y'all sent me to the college campus to make Jesus known among college students. And it's awesome. So I'm super excited to be here with y'all this morning. I always love preaching at UPC all the time. It's definitely a different vibe than preaching at some random room that we get to use on campus. It's a lot of fun. So this semester, what we've been doing is we've been going through this series called The Story, and I've just been walking with students through the story of the Bible, through what, in other words, we might call redemptive history, what it is that God has been up to in all his dealings with his people and with his creation. The big claim, of course, is that the Bible is not a collection of myths, it's not a collection of fables, it's not a collection of biographies of people to be emulated. It's one long story, it's a rescue mission, it's a love story. In some ways, the Bible is this great big love letter written by a loving God who wouldn't sit idly by as his people self-destructed. And so, this sermon from 1 Corinthians 15, it comes halfway through the semester. I preached it a couple weeks ago at RUF, a large group, so if you were there, if you were a college student, you were present, you get to hear it again. And if not, then I hope that it's profitable for you. What we have here in 1 Corinthians 15 is we have the culmination up to this point of what this rescue mission entails. I'm reminded of the story of when I was about to propose to Brittany, who is now my wife. She's out of town, which is why you don't see her. But I'm reminded of just the process of proposing, of getting from that point where I was thinking to myself, this is a woman I love and I can't see myself living without, to the point of spending way too much money on a ring, to the point of recruiting our friends and our family to put on this thing, this plan, to propose to her in a way that would honor and speak and communicate the love and the commitment that I was trying to communicate. If you are you're dating someone, by the way, this is like friendly advice. If you are thinking of proposing to someone, just make it a thing. Just put some thought into it. Don't be super casual about it, because it's a big deal. And so what that entailed for us is, In the weeks leading up to the actual proposal, I was living in Jacksonville, Florida. She was living here. And we were going to get engaged in Atlanta, where we both grew up, which meant that there was a lot of remote work going on. I was doing remote work before COVID forced us all to do remote work. And so I was calling people and trying to plan and trying to scheme and trying to get them all on the same page so that we could have this beautiful scene where I would take her to this park in downtown Atlanta in front of this beautiful fountain, and it would be this lasting memory. Now, the thing about plans, whether it be a proposal or a birthday party or whatever the case may be, is that they're just plans, they're just hypothetical until the actual thing happens. And in some ways, the anticipation of it makes the actual event unfolding so much sweeter. And so when the proposal actually happened, it was this beautiful culmination of so many people who loved us and who supported us coming together to help make this thing a reality. The plans came together, and here was the scene. That's where we're at here in 1 Corinthians 15. You see, leading up to this point in the Bible, what we have is we have the story of a God who's been dropping breadcrumbs throughout the story of the Bible, dropping breadcrumbs about what this redemption of his people is going to look like, how he's planning and moving whole nations and dictating the history of the world, dictating the contours of the hearts of people and of the politics of nation states, and dictating geography itself, and dictating stuff like rain and like Red Sea splitting in half, doing all this stuff, dropping these breadcrumbs, and we see this anticipation until finally we get the culmination. The thing is actually happening, and it is glorious. And so that's what we are in 1 Corinthians 15. I'm going to read the first 11 verses. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believe in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believe. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the Scriptures. Thank you for your Holy Spirit inspiring the Apostle Paul to write down these beautiful words, this beautiful reminder of the content of your rescue mission. Thank you for being a God who doesn't give up on his people, even when we give up on you, for continuing to pursue your people, for continuing to love your people, for chasing us down with your grace, and for bringing us into your family. Lord, I pray that we would look more like Jesus day after day, and that the preaching of your word this morning would help us to look more like your son. In your son's name I pray. So we have 1 Corinthians 15 as we have a reminder of the gospel, a reminder of the content of the gospel. I'm not going to give this big, long lecture on the context of the book of 1 Corinthians, but just the very general gist. You have the Corinthians, who Corinth was this very wealthy city in the ancient world. It was a center of trade, a center of arts, a center of philosophy. These were educated people, and these were people that tended to think that they were better than other people in the ancient world because they were Corinthians. They're not like those dusty Las Cruces. No, they're Corinthians. And so they tended to think that they were a little bit better. There was this class divide that was going on in the church in Corinth. And so what we see a few chapters earlier is that Paul is speaking, militating against this notion that there's an inner circle to this Christianity thing, that some people are more deserving of being in the family of God than other people. And then he starts talking about some innovations that the Corinthians had started introducing into their worship and into how they understood what it meant to be people of God. And what Paul gives them to ground them, to bring them back to reality, is this very simple and succinct reminder of the gospel. The stuff of Christianity, the building blocks, the atoms, that the protons and neutrons and electrons, the quarks of what it is to be a Christian, the work of Christ on your behalf, the work of Christ on behalf of God. And so what this boils down to, basically two things, two points. Number one, Paul is reminding them of the coherence of the gospel. The gospel is coherent. And Paul is reminding them of the power of the gospel. The gospel accomplishes things in time and space. The coherence of the gospel and the power of the gospel. We start with the first one, the coherence of the gospel. Now, what we have in verses 3 to 5, many biblical scholars agree, is probably Paul quoting a very early Christian creed. You can think of it kind of like a catechism. Some have likened verses 3 to 5. This is to the New Testament what the Shema is to the Old Testament. Like the thesis statement of the faith that unites all these people. One historian theologian has said, and this is a quote, "This is the kind of foundation story with which a community is not at liberty to tamper. It was probably formulated within the first 2 or 3 years after Easter itself, since it was already in formulated form when Paul received it." And so what that means is that the stuff that he's reminding the Corinthians of, potentially, is something that they would have catechized their children with, something that they would repeat to each other over and over to be reminded of what it is that they all believe, what it is that unites them as Christians. It's not their nationality. It's not the fact that they're Corinthians. It's not the fact that they're educated or wealthy. It's not the fact that they're Roman citizens. It's this. Verses 3 to 5. A succinct and early Christian creed. Now, this is important for us, and hopefully it'll help us approach the stuff of our faith with more confidence. Because there are conspiracy theories about everything. Nowadays, everyone has some wild thought about everything. One of the conspiracy theories that's floating around, and it's been floating around for a while, is that Christianity was invented sometime around the Council of Nicaea by the Emperor Constantine. And that's a conspiracy theory floating around, that you have these disparate kind of myths about this man, Jesus, and then as a sort of slimy political move, this emperor of the Roman Empire took these myths together and forced these people to come together and came up with this mythology that was going to be this political tool. That's a conspiracy theory that's out there about the origin of Christianity. But when we look at the content of this early creed, what we see is that the stuff of Christianity, the gospel, it wasn't invented in the 4th century. This is a very early document. The letter to the Corinthians was written probably between 50 and 60 AD. That's less than a generation after the death of Jesus. Right, and if this is being presented as something that Paul is quoting as this thing that, you know, we all agree, right? This is the stuff that we all learned. This is the stuff that we all grew up reciting. Well, it stands to reason that it wasn't invented by this secret underground cabal of people trying to come up with this political manipulation tool. It should give us a great deal of confidence that very early on, Christians agreed, yeah, this is the work of Jesus. This is the content of the gospel. The gospel is coherent. It's not this constellation of unrelated mythologies. It is a coherent message. It is a coherent story. So I want to present to you, I want to propose to you this morning that the gospel is coherent in two ways. That it's coherent theologically and that it's coherent historically. Theologically and historically. So, let's look at what Paul is actually writing, starting verse 3. "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures." Do you catch that? Do you catch this phrase that Paul repeats, that this creed repeats, that they go out of their way to communicate that the stuff that Jesus did, that the content of their belief, that the content of the gospel is what? In accordance with the Scriptures. Now, this is easier to see if we've been tracking the story of redemption throughout the Bible. If we've been taking God seriously as he's been revealing himself to his people throughout Scripture. If we've been taking the story of redemption seriously as it's been unfolding in the story of Israel and in the story of the first Christians. One thing that I have repeated over and over this semester is that when we look at the stuff of redemption and we take God seriously in how he reveals himself to his people, we shouldn't be shocked by the gospel. We should be expecting something like the gospel. Because God doesn't change his mind. He doesn't go back on who he says he is. He doesn't go back on his promises. And I think that's what Paul's getting at here in 1 Corinthians 15. The stuff that Jesus did, the stuff that this first century Jewish man did for God's people is in accordance with the Scriptures. It's been there all along. We wouldn't even say hiding in plain sight. It's just in plain sight. It's just there. What do I mean? Well, let's take a look at the first phrase, that Jesus died in accordance with the scriptures. There's an Old Testament passage. I'm just going to, a very quick survey of the Old Testament stuff. So there's an Old Testament passage that we read a lot during Easter time, which is Isaiah 52 and 53. Right? Isaiah raises this question of this figure who he calls the servant of the Lord. And as we look at the stuff that when we look at the stuff that Isaiah has been saying about the servant of the Lord, what we start to understand is that initially the servant of the Lord is this figure who fulfills the stuff that Israel was supposed to do. But then as we look further on, we see that the servant of the Lord actually redeems Israel, and so the servant can't be Israel itself. It's another figure who was both Israel in its perfect sense, but also distinct from Israel, who would save the people of God. And then this is what we see happens to this servant figure in Isaiah 53, verse 5, that he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. The death of Christ is theologically coherent. God has been announcing it for hundreds, even thousands of years. Even starting in Genesis 3, when he told us from the very beginning what it would cost for his people to be redeemed, what it would cost for the serpent to be crushed. But then not only did he die in accordance with the scriptures, he was also raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Now this one's a little bit more nebulous. Some biblical scholars have scratch their heads wondering what exactly is the piece that's in accordance with the scriptures. Is it just the rising again from the dead, or if it's the third day stuff? Generally speaking, I think it's both of them. And we get certain hints about this throughout the Bible. One of them, for example, is something that Jesus appeals to when people ask him for a sign. He talks about the sign of Jonah, right? Being taken to Sheol and then being spit out of Sheol on the third day. That's something. We see in Hosea chapter 6, again, the prophet Hosea taking on the perspective of the people of Israel, which we learn from the prophet Isaiah, that Jesus is the perfect Israel. This is Hosea speaking from the perspective of Israel. Come, let us return to the Lord, for he has torn us that he may heal us. He has struck us down and he will bind us up. After 2 days he will revive us. On the third day he will raise us up that we may live. It's Hosea 6, verses 1 and 2. Not only was Jesus' death theologically coherent, his resurrection on the third day is theologically coherent. The apostles, the first century Christians, aren't just coming along and saying, how can we come up with the tallest tale we can think of? They're taking the Bible seriously. And they're looking at what God has said he would do. And they're taking it seriously. And the tragedy is that people who purported to take God very seriously saw the gospel unfolding before their very eyes, and they didn't recognize it. And I think it's because they didn't actually take it seriously. Biblical authors take great care to make sure that when they're saying stuff, that the stuff that they're saying actually lines up with the Bible. Now, for these first century people, the New Testament canon hadn't been finalized. So when Paul's saying in accordance with the scriptures, he is talking about the Old Testament, right? We see this all over the New Testament. People showing their receipts. Like, here's where it is in the Old Testament that this was going to happen. I think this is something that we ought to learn from these New Testament writers and from Old Testament writers. Because oftentimes, and this is something that I've just seen being on social media, there's a bunch of people just on like TikTok or Instagram Reels or whatever, and they're sharing what they believe are truths about God, truths about the gospel, and when you actually dive into it, there's no biblical grounding for it. Oftentimes, it's just based on like vibes or how it makes us feel. So I think something that we can learn from this I would even say fascination with the stuff of our faith being theologically coherent, is that when we come across these claims about God, these claims about the Bible, these claims about Jesus, like, our first question should be, where is that in Scripture? Where is that in the Bible? Because God is consistent. And the gospel is consistent. And I don't think it's just young people with social media, with TikTok and Instagram and stuff like that. I think any of us, I guess, but any of us can be easily swayed by what feels right, by what feels true. Y'all, we have the Bible, and the Bible is true. And so when we have these crises of, okay, what's true? This feels right, this doesn't feel quite right, let's appeal to what the early Christians appealed to, which is the Bible, the Word of God. Unerring revelation of who God is and what he's done throughout redemptive history. So the gospel is theologically coherent. It's also historically coherent. Notice, let's go back to verse 5. But he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. You recall that quote that I read earlier from that Bible historian. There's this incredible risk that these early Christians are taking when they're making these bold claims about the content of the gospel, and it's this. A lot of the people who were there to witness the stuff they're talking about were still alive when these things happened. There's built-in accountability for me being in this room, and you know, those of you who were here last week, for me coming here and saying, this and this and this thing happened last week. Do y'all remember last week when that meteor crashed through the roof? And we all freaked out and we had to call the fire department? I can't just stand here and say that because you were there. And it clearly didn't happen. If Paul is just making stuff up, it'd be like him standing in this room saying, you know, remember that meteor. There were people there who witnessed what happened. And so he's making stuff up. He's taking this incredible risk for what reason? Just so he can be arrested and stoned and killed eventually? You see, the gospel is not just theologically coherent, it's historically coherent. What I mean by that is that it's actually the work, the redemptive work of Jesus on behalf of his people in time and in space. The Bible is not just a collection of people who had weird hallucinogenic visions and then wrote it down. The Bible is not just a collection of aphorisms and sayings and philosophical propositions that we ponder and consider. The Bible is a story of a God, the author of this story who has written himself into the story. The Bible is the story of stuff that actually happened in history. And look, I know many of us have grown up reading these Bible stories, and many of us have grown up being kind of churchy people, and so maybe this is trite by now, maybe this is not revelatory or something like that, but it's actually huge that the Bible is telling a story about things that happened in history, things that are verifiable, things where you could go to the Middle East and dig stuff up and see that it existed. That should give us a great deal of confidence. And it should give us a sense of understanding that the gospel is not about the secret knowledge that we acquire through meditation. It's about God entering into history and dealing with real life people. And so what that means is that the gospel has real life implications. Now, I say that and it sounds obvious, but I think for some of us who are Reformed and we love our theology, and I love Reformed theology, like the R and R U F stands for Reformed, I think Reformed theology is awesome. And I think one of the pitfalls that some of us who are more like theologically inclined can fall into is we can be satisfied with a gospel that is merely coherent. We can be satisfied with a gospel that satisfies our intellect. But what we see here in 1 Corinthians 15 is that the gospel is not just coherent, it's also powerful. In other words, the gospel is not just intellectually satisfying, it is existentially uncompromising. When God's grace takes a hold of people, when God's grace goes into dark places, things actually happen in time and in space. Recently, Brent and I watched this movie called The Martian. I've seen it a few times. I think it's a pretty cool movie. So just the general plot of the movie, Matt Damon goes to Mars, gets stranded on Mars, and people try to rescue Matt Damon. That's kind of the plot of the movie. And so there's this one scene, maybe three quarters of the way into the movie, where Matt Damon's character is convinced that he will not be rescued from Mars, that he's going to die on this planet alone, so far away from any other human being. So he radios his crew that's like orbiting around the planet, trying to figure out how to rescue him. He radios them and he tells them, I'm going to die here. I want you to give this message to my parents. And this is what he says. He says, tell them I'm dying for something good and beautiful and greater than me. Tell them I'm dying for something good and beautiful and greater than me. Which is a fantastic line, and it's beautiful, and it's so affecting, right? It's one thing to know that Mars exists, and to have our intellectual curiosity about the gravitation on Mars satisfied. It's another thing to be so smitten with the curiosity of learning more about this planet and loving this planet to be able to say, tell them I'm dying for something good and beautiful and greater than me. It's one thing to recognize that the gospel is coherent. It's another thing altogether to experience the power of the gospel. Because the power of the gospel looks like this. The best, most beautiful, and greatest one died for his people, so that his people could live for something good and beautiful and greater than themselves. This is the power of the gospel. The gospel actually changes things in time and space. We see that in verse 8. Paul does this thing that he does often where he shares his testimony. And if we're familiar with the story of Paul, then we're thinking to ourselves, yeah, like I can't think of anyone else whose life was so incredibly revolutionary, transformed by the power of Jesus. This is what Paul says about his story. He says, last of all, as to one untimely born, Jesus appeared also to me. Why does he consider himself one untimely born? Well, he explains, for I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. What is this religion that turns someone like Paul? What is this person who turns someone like Paul, an enemy of God, someone intent on leading Christians to their death, into not an enemy of God who's intent on leading Christians to their death, but a friend of God intent on leading non-Christians to their life? What is the power of this thing? How does that happen? Paul tells us it's grace. It's the grace of God. Do you notice what Paul doesn't say? Paul doesn't say, I used to be a pretty bad guy, but then I went to therapy and I started working on myself and I did the work and I figured some stuff out and I realized that I had some trauma to deal with and now I'm an apostle. Look, I'm not knocking therapy. My wife is a counselor. I think therapy is amazing. But Paul's not saying, I worked really hard so now I'm an apostle. No, that's precisely what he's not saying. He's saying, when I encountered Jesus, when he found me on that dusty road to Damascus, and I was on my way to slaughter his people, everything changed. The gospel is not just intellectually stimulating, intellectually satisfying. It is existentially uncompromising. The gospel is the culmination of God's rescue mission to turn his enemies into his children. Now maybe you're thinking to yourself, yeah, well, that's very good for Paul to kill people. And last time I checked, I haven't gone on this killing spree of Christians. You know, maybe the extent of the bad stuff that I do is every once in a while I look at things on the computer that I shouldn't. Who's that part? Every once in a while I maybe speak a little bit too quickly or rush to conclusions, or maybe I get mad, or maybe I share a thing that was given to me in confidence, but like in the grand scheme of things, I'm not Paul. Like, the gospel doesn't have to be that powerful. It can just be a little powerful. Okay? There's this musician, his name is Sufjan Stevens, and I've quoted him a couple times at RUF, and pretty consistently, college students don't know who I'm talking about, which makes me sad. So Sufjan Stevens is this indie folk musician, and he has this song titled John Wayne Gacy Jr. So if you're familiar with who that person is, who that individual is, he is a famous serial killer, which is a crazy thing to say. Like, terrible things, right? And so Sufjan Stevens writes this song about this horrendous serial killer. And this is how he ends the song. Pay attention to the lyrics. He says, "And in my best behavior, I'm really just like him. Look beneath the floorboards for the secrets I have hid." I don't think Sufjan Stevens is confessing to murder. I actually think what he's saying, what he's putting his finger on, is the fact that the problem isn't that we're bad people. Because if the problem is that we're bad people, then I can compare my badness to your badness, and my badness does not measure up to the badness that Paul is talking about. The problem is not that we're bad people. The problem is that we're dead people. The problem is that it's not what you will find underneath the proverbial floorboards, it's that you'll find something. And that means that we're dead people apart from the work of Jesus. And so we find ourselves saying something like, yeah, Paul is a pretty bad guy, but I'm not. I would say that we don't understand the depth of our sin. We don't understand how desperately we are for grace apart from the work of Christ. We don't understand that it's not about how bad we are, it's about how dead we are. And look, I'm not a doctor, I'm not a medical professional. I'm pretty sure you're either just dead or not dead. Problem isn't that we're bad, it's that we're dead. But the grace of God brings dead people to life. This is the power of the gospel. The redemption that God is bringing about throughout the story of the Bible is him speaking life into his people that they might live once again. And what do living people do? They respond to his grace. Their lives are different. They change. Y'all, like, Paul is this extreme example of what God can do. If he can bring someone like Paul into his family, who can't he bring into his family? What can he do? Whose deadness can't the gospel breathe life into? Because I think if we think that someone is beyond the reach of God's grace, what we're really thinking, what we really assume, is that we somehow deserve it. That if we receive the grace of God, it's because we did something to help. And that's just not how grace works. And y'all, there's something really beautiful about the way Paul talks about how God's grace not only found him and brought him to life, right? But it also sustains him. It also keeps him. It also maintains him. Verse 10, "But by the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Here's the challenge for us. God's grace, again, it's not just this propositional, philosophical idea that we just sit with, and we're content with just sitting on the couch and thinking about grace only. Paul gets it. God's grace actually does things in your life. It leads us to actually respond out of gratitude, out of understanding that because we've received everything, because we don't have to work to earn God's favor, because he's given us his favor, irrespective of what we've done, we respond with gratitude. You see, the gospel is not only powerful because it changes the lives of Christians. The gospel is powerful because Christians change the world. Because in responding to gratitude, Christians go out into a world that is thirsty for life, that is thirsty for grace, that is thirsty for the goodness of God. And we dare to tell these dark places there is light. And we dare to tell these dead places there is life. The gospel is powerful. It's powerful. And it's not just the building blocks that we move past. We don't graduate past the gospel. We dive deeper into it because we understand more and more that it's God's grace and God's grace alone that keeps us in standing. So there's a couple challenges for us, I think. Well, number one, well, Paul's talking about upends the meritocracy that we've learned as the grammar of how we understand human relationships, right? So what I'm not saying is this. I'm not saying that we should just stop working because it's not a meritocracy. It's all grace. We should just like expect to receive a paycheck without doing anything. That's not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is that the kingdom of God works differently. That the economy of the kingdom of God looks like this. You receive everything on the front end. And then your life is a reflection of having received everything. Therefore, when Paul says something like, I worked harder than any of them, we don't read that as him striving to make something of himself. We read that as God having made him something. And he can now live like something that he is. If you're a Christian, your life is not this 80-year struggle to make something of yourself. If you're a Christian, God has made you something. And you get to live life like something that he says you are. I come from an immigrant family. We moved to the U.S. when I was 7 years old, which means that the first few years of living in this country were years of poverty, years of scarcity, and so I have these reflexes inside of me that I have to learn to shut down when I'm thinking about the economy of God's kingdom, because I take a look at life from a scarcity mindset. I tend to look at life as just this ongoing struggle to eliminate this, to neutralize threat, to hoard wealth because it might go away. I think so many of us, for whatever reason, can tend to treat the gospel in this way. We have our theological categories. We have our confessions and our catechisms and our creeds. We're content to hoard it because maybe it's a scarce resource. But then we see Jesus saying something like, you are the salt of the earth. And when he says something like that, I hope that we start to read in between the lines and realize that being salt, it's a metaphor, we're not really salt, but to be salt means to be spread. The point of the church is not to build a bigger salt shaker. It's actually to shake the salt shaker. And I think that sometimes we are so concerned with our scarcity that instead of figuring out, okay, how can this powerful gospel that actually affects things in time and space impact the people and the places that we have contact with, we plug up the holes in the salt shaker because we're afraid of the threats. Y'all, We are being sent into a dark and thirsty world. And the power of the gospel means that as we're sent into a dark and thirsty and dead world, people like Paul will come alive. Because God is in the business of taking his enemies, even his worst enemies, even enemies of his who are actively out to kill the church, and he turns them into beautiful works of art. So this should challenge our fear. Right now we're living in this just conversation about how everything is us versus them. Yeah, there's a sense in which people who don't know Jesus are enemies of God. That's true. But it's not us versus them. God doesn't conquer his enemies by keeping them at bay. He conquers them by bringing them in. And we got an opportunity to be a church, to be a people, to be Christians who live like that's actually true. Let's pray. Father, we believe, we affirm that we were once your enemies. That if we're Christians, it's not because we worked so hard, it's not because you thought that we were so intelligent or so apt at our skill sets, but because you are gracious, because you bring people in, because you bring dead people to life. So Lord, let us be shaped by your mission. Let us be shaped by the gospel. Let us be shaped by what Jesus has done in our path. Let our lives be a response of gratitude to the grace.